I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Friends, good morning. My name is Jeremy Pegram, the pastor here at First United Methodist Church, and I want to welcome you to this service of worship. It is certainly my hope and my prayer that all of us will have an encounter with the living Christ as we worship together this morning. If you are worshiping by way of live stream this morning, I also want to extend a warm welcome to you wherever you might be around the world today, and also hope that you will experience God's love right where you are. If this is your first time here in the sanctuary, I do hope that you will take one of these welcome visitor cards and complete the bottom portion. Drop that off into the offering plate a little bit later, and I do hope that we can get to know one another through that. And then if you're worshiping at home by way of live stream, please take a moment at the conclusion of today's worship service and scroll down where you will find a video description there below the video. If you're watching on YouTube, you will find a link where you can register your attendance. That does help us get an accurate count of how many people are worshiping with us. I do have some additional announcements to share with you this morning. One, we will have a blood drive here tomorrow in the Family Life Center from noon until 4:30. Hope you will come out to give the gift of life. And also, since it is Memorial Day tomorrow, the church office will be closed, and so we'll be back in the office on Tuesday. And then lastly, want to remind you that next Sunday following worship, we will have a picnic lunch out on the front lawn. Invite everybody to bring your own picnic basket, all the things you need to eat and to drink, a blanket or some chairs, and we'll celebrate the Pentecost, the birth of the church, together outside next Sunday. And if the weather is not so great, we'll just move it into the Family Life Center. Again, friends, I want to welcome you to this service of worship today. If you will now stand, take a United Methodist hymnal, turn to page 159, so that we may join in heart and in voice and sing together, Lift High the Cross.
Oh,
friends, you may be seated, and as you do, I invite you to be in a spirit of prayer as we approach the throne of grace this morning. Let us go to God in prayer. Almighty God, you have made us and all things to serve you. Now prepare the world for your rule. Come quickly to save us, so that wars and violence shall end, and your children may live in peace, honoring one another with justice and love. Almighty God, look with compassion upon all involved in the recent shootings in our country and around the world. Comfort those traumatized by these horrendous events. Wrap your everlasting arms around those who mourn. Heal those whose hearts and minds are terrorized. Strengthen those medical personnel who minister to the wounded. Protect the law enforcement officials who risk their lives for our safety. And calm all whose memories of violence are triggered by these shootings. We pray for parents whose lives have been forever changed as their children have been taken by cruelty and hate. We pray for teachers and school administrators who give their very lives to shield the innocent. Renew our nation in the ways of justice and peace. Guide those who make and administer our laws to build a society based on trust and respect. Free us all from crime and violence. Guard our youth from the perils of drugs and materialism, and give all citizens a new vision of a life of harmony. Send your spirit and renew the face of the earth. Teach us to be compassionate toward the whole human family. Strengthen the will of all who advocate for justice and peace, and lead all nations and all peoples into the path of peace, and give us your peace, which surpasses all understanding. For we ask all of these things in the mighty name of Jesus, who taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, this morning I come to you with a question. Are you thankful? Yes, all right, good answer, all right. I don't have the baskets up here, but they'll make their way up here along with those that are going to pass those this morning. We will pass these baskets and share what we are thankful for and make a contribution so we can pass those blessings on to others. And we are passing them on to Becca Bray. This will be the last Sunday as we're collecting a love offering for her to help with expenses related to Vincent's death. So what are you thankful for this morning? Sunshine? Those who sacrifice for our freedoms, absolutely.
Family.
For family. Susan. Wow. Absolutely. Thank you for lifting that up. Absolutely. Anyone else? Another successful year of preschool. We had graduation the other night. It was awesome. We certainly have a lot to pray for and also a lot to be thankful for, and we certainly don't understand all the violence that is in our world. I'm going to speak to that a little bit later, but for now, I do want to lift up Memorial Day, which is tomorrow. Thank you, Petrina, for mentioning that. And Memorial Day, not to be confused with Veterans Day, is indeed the day that we honor those who have died in military service. We honor those who died in war and those who have fallen to pay the ultimate sacrifice for our freedom. So I invite you, friends, to stand and join with me in the Memorial Day litany that is printed in your bulletin. Let us give thanks to God for the land of our birth with all its chartered liberties, for all the wonder of our country's story. For leaders in nation and state, and for those who in days past and in these present times have labored for the commonwealth. For those in all times and places have been true and brave, and in the world's common ways have lived upright lives and ministered to their fellows. For those who serve their country in its hour of need, and especially for those who gave even their lives in that service. O Almighty God and most merciful Father, as we remember these your servants, remembering with gratitude their courage and strength, we hold before you those who mourn them. Look upon your bereaved servants with your mercy, as this day brings them memories of those they have lost a while. May it also bring your consolation and the assurance that their loved ones are alive now and forever in your living presence. And all of God's children said, Amen. You may be seated.
Children, don't you get weary, there's a great camp meeting in the
Friends, let us now turn our attention to the reading and the hearing of God's holy word. Our scripture lesson for today is taken from Romans chapter 6, verses 1 through 11. And it is my hope and my prayer that God will add a blessing to the reading and the hearing of these ancient words. Hear them now. What shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? By no means. We are those who have died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? Or don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly also be united with him in a resurrection like his. For we know that our old self was crucified with him, so that the body ruled by sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin, because anyone who has died has been set free from sin. Now, if we died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. For we know that since Christ was raised from the dead, he cannot die again. Death no longer has mastery over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. In the same way, count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. Friends, this is the word of God given to us, the people of God. Together may we say, thanks be to God. Will you pray with me? Almighty God, may the words of my mouth and may the meditations of all of our hearts be pleasing in your sight. For we trust that you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. I know several of you have signed up for the trip that we are taking to Israel next February and March, and I'm looking forward to that. And Alice and I have been talking about that, and she's been asking a lot of questions about my first trip there, and which made me think about my trip there, but also my trip home. And we boarded the plane in Tel Aviv to make our way back to the United States late one evening. I forgot what day of the week it is at this point, but it might have been about 9 o'clock at night we were boarding the plane. It's about a 10.5 hour flight, so I plan to get nestled in and go to sleep and then wake up in America. That was my hope. And as I boarded the plane, though, I found that I was going to be a lucky one and have a middle seat all the way home, and with no leg room and no elbow room and no way to really get comfortable. And I was sitting between a mother and a son. And they were on their way from Israel back to the United States. They lived in both countries. They had dual citizenship, so they could live in both. And the mother leans over to me and she goes, "You're going to be able to sleep the whole ride back. It's going to be amazing." You see, I was in the Israeli army and have had great training, so I will be able to sneak out of my seat. She was in the window seat, by the way. I'll be able to sneak out of my seat, climb over you, and you will have no idea that I even got up. And so in the middle of a REM cycle about 2 in the morning, I'm dreaming about an American hamburger. I had not had one in 11 days. Think about all the cheese and the grease and the beef patty and all of that I was planning to ingest as soon as my feet hit American soil. I'm over there having this great dream, and then all of a sudden I began to feel something pressing into my shoulder. It wasn't annoying. It's like if you ever fish or been swimming in a pond or in a lake and a fish comes up to nibble your leg a little bit, it was just a little light nibble, a little light bump like that. Finally, I woke up and she whispers, "I have to go to the bathroom." I thought, well, what happened to your Israeli ninja skills? Here I am in dreamland of McDonald's or wherever, and you're waking me up to go to the restroom. I was really confused by that. But nevertheless, we finished the flight and came back home, but it struck me, this idea of having a dual citizenship, because I feel like that's where we live as Christians, that we live in the kingdom of God, and we know all the benefits and the beauty and the grace that comes with that, but at the same time, we also live in this world. And Susan, just as you mentioned, we face the reality of hell and death and sin every day. So this morning, I want to just share some reflections about how we might live as a people of faith in both places, within the kingdom of God, but then also within the reality of this world. So as I pondered this passage this week and looked at these verses, a few of the things that we can take from this is that, one, through our baptisms, we have been raised to new life, and we have a new identity in Christ. Our sin has been washed away, and God no longer looks upon us as sinful creatures. We might even refer to the psalmist who writes, "As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us." And when we are baptized, God seals his decision to claim us as his own and erases our sin and gives us new life and new citizenship. And this death to sin also comes with an eternal promise that, just as we sung about in the anthem, that one day we will indeed reach the promised land, a place where sin will no longer rule and reign. But I share with you this morning that this death to sin that we have experienced, this new found freedom, also comes with great responsibility. Just as those who gave of their lives for our country in military service to grant our freedom, that same freedom as American citizens come with great responsibility. And the same freedom that Christ gives us from our sins, as he being the one who paid the ultimate sacrifice for our sins, also offers to us a high calling to be his presence in the world, to offer his grace and his love. And I believe that one way we do that is by offering compassion to one another. And I believe that that compassion can make this world look a whole lot more like God's kingdom, where hell and death have indeed been conquered. Compassion is a shared experience. It grows out of seeds of love within the human heart. And as I was reading this week, I found one line that says, "Compassion is getting inside the skin of another." It is having a deep connection with someone else. If we are sitting with someone who is hurting or is aching, we breathe in their pain, and then they breathe in our compassion. A compassionate person identifies with someone who is suffering and makes space in our lives. Being compassionate doesn't mean that we're in Christ's holy church. We have this high calling, like Christ, to offer compassion to the world, a world that is stricken with sin. And I believe as we do that, that compassion will be contagious. It will catch on and it will spread like wildfire, and more people will share compassion and experience compassion, and this world can indeed be changed. I experienced a beautiful act of compassion a few years ago. I mentioned in a couple of sermons back that a few years ago, I went to a place in Alabama called Wetumpka, and we made a W sign with our fingers like this while we were there. We were in Wetumpka, Alabama. While there in Wetumpka, I was working with a youth group. It was a youth group from my church, and we had converged upon this little small town with several other youth groups, and there was a group there, or a program called, I forget what it's called, it doesn't matter. But anyway, they were there to put on the mission trip for the week, and they arranged all the mission activities for our students and moved them from place to place, and they engaged in lots of different things. And one of the places where we went to work happened to be smack dab right in the middle of a trailer park. You see, a United Methodist Church had gone into this trailer park community and purchased a double-wide trailer right in the middle of all the other homes there. And they established that that trailer or that double wide would then be a community center for the families and the children within that trailer park. They would hold worship services there and Bible study and do devotionals. And during the day, during the summertime while we were there, all the mission teams would come in and they would put on what they called Kids Club during the day. It was kind of like vacation Bible school. So all the children within the trailer park could come there and they could gather in that space and they could be taught by the youth and by the adult leaders and they could learn Bible stories and they could pray and have games. It was a fun time. Kept them out of trouble, but also kept them out of their parents' hair, but also gave them something to do and something constructive right there in their own community, in their own place. So we happened to be there the last week of Kids Club, and the church made a plan that on Wednesday night, they would invite everyone over from the community for a cookout, and they had hot dogs. And I like those just as much as I like hamburgers. And so I was really looking forward to the hot dog supper. But anyway, so they had hot dogs, and they invited all the neighbors from the trailer park in, and then the pastor got up and he said this. He said, "We're going to pass out a form, and we invite you to put your name on it and your children's names, and then fill in their school list, everything they're going to need for back to school." You see, it was approaching mid-August. And he said, "If you give us that list, then come back next Wednesday night. We will have everything that you need or everything that your child needs to start a new school year." And so as I'm standing there with a ketchup running down my arm, I silently pray to God, I would really love to serve a church like that one day. I would really love to see a church be that compassionate and that engaged in its community. And in 2020, my friends, God answered that prayer and sent me here to you. This is a church full of love and full of compassion. A few weeks ago, our leadership board started a visioning process for our church because we want to know where we're going. We all know that without a vision, the people perish, and we don't want to do that. We want to know where God is sending us and what God is calling us to do. When we're using a program called Discovering God's Future for Your Church. And at the end of it, we will have a vision. It's going to take us several months. We will have a vision, and we will know what the next faithful step that God is calling us to take. But first, we have to figure out who we are as a congregation and study our congregational identity. And we have to look at our culture and our history, and then most of all, our core values. So I want to share with you this morning the draft of the core values that the leadership team has come up with. There's going to be a little editing and a little work on these, but these are broad categories that I want to share this morning. And these are the core values of this congregation. Number one, community involvement. Before anything else, we want to be engaged with the community around us. Number two, through dynamic worship, through music and preaching, we want to strengthen our faith. Number three, we want to study God's Word. Christian education and discipleship and the education of others is in our DNA. This church got started in an academy, by the way, if you didn't know that. And then this church is family-oriented. All generations are welcome, all generations are nurtured, and specifically, we offer preschool and vacation Bible school to offer a strong foundation to invite children into the family of God. And then number five, we are a congregation that cares for others, and we are a congregation that expresses and lives into extravagant generosity. That is who this church is, and I've come to believe that. A few weeks ago, Julie forwarded an email to me from a social worker here in the East Surrey District of Surrey County Schools, And we had a phone conversation this past week, and turns out that apparently sometime along the way, and I think the pandemic halted all of this, that our church was responsible for making it possible for children at Westfield Elementary School to have shoes to go back to school. And because of the pandemic and different things, that had stopped, and not any fault to the church or to the school system, it's just things couldn't take place. So when I spoke to Jennifer Stone, the social worker, this past week, she asked me, would we be able to commit $1,000 to be able to provide vouchers for children to get the shoes they need to start the school year with? And without hesitation, I was able to say, yes, our church will do that. I didn't have to have a committee meeting. We didn't have to have a vote. We didn't have to take minutes. We didn't have to have a motion and a second and all of those things. In my heart, I just knew that the generosity and the compassion and the care that is in this place would allow me to say yes. And I truly believe that it's that kind of compassion and that kind of love and that kind of care of this place that we can be instruments of peace in this world. And we can be a church that helps to change the world. So that indeed there will come a day and come a time when all children will make it home at night. And their parents and their loved ones can tuck them in and let them know of their love. And there will come a day when all teachers and administrators can teach and lead without having to be human shields in their classroom. I believe compassion, the compassion of Jesus Christ, can change the world. And I believe it starts right here in this place and the way we carry that love and that compassion out in the community. It's an awesome feeling to serve a church like this, knowing that among our core values is care and generosity. It's awesome to serve in this place knowing that, one, we live in God's world, in God's kingdom. And even though we still have to deal with the reality of sin in this world, and we know that there is still the sting of death, and we know that sin still can cause great harm, we are citizens of God's kingdom, and we will do our part to usher in a day when God will make all things new, a day when death will be no more, a day when there will be no more mourning or crying or pain. And as the prophet Isaiah writes, the day when the wolf will live with a lamb and the leopard will lie down with the goat, the calf and the lion and the yearling together, and a little child will lead them. The cow will feed with the bear, the young will lie down together, the lion will eat straw like the ox, the infant will play near the cobra's den, and the young child will put its hand into the viper's nest. They will neither harm nor destroy on all my holy mountain, says the Lord. For the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the seas. May our compassion be contagious, because first we know the compassion of Jesus, the one who made the ultimate sacrifice for us to redeem us, to set us free, so that we can be enabled and empowered to offer his compassion to an aching and hurting world, so that all will come to know his love and his grace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And now, friends, if our ushers would come to receive our tithes and our offerings, may we give back to God out of what God has so richly blessed us with. now, friends, let us dedicate these gifts using the prayer of dedication that is printed in your bulletin. Will you pray with me? As we offer our treasure in hearts to you, O God, may they be used to pass on the promise of hope, of peace, of life, of community to all in need of your gifts and presence in their lives. Amen. And now, friends, let us sing together America the Beautiful, hymn number 696. Before, but it was the night before I went into the first grade, my mother decided to run my shoes through the wash so they would be nice and shiny for the first day of school. And that morning when we were getting ready, she opened the dryer and only one shoe was in there. Now, we're all used to like one sock, you know. There's always that one sock that you can ever find a match for, and it will show up after you have finally moved that sock or repurposed it onto something else. Nevertheless, though, I had a pair of cowboy boots, so I was boot scooting all the way to the first grade, and it was awesome. So I had a backup pair. But there are a lot of kids, a lot of children in our community who just have what they have. And sometimes they grow out of them, and their feet have to be crammed in, or they have no shoes at all. You know, 1 in 5 children right here in our community suffer from food insecurity and live in homes where there's a lot of poverty, and where there are drugs, and where there are problems. But friends, I hope it will be our mission that in those homes and in our community, they will know of love and compassion, because that's what Christ calls us to do. I also hope that when you leave here today, that you will know that you are loved by God, that you are covered in the grace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit to be with you always. Go in love and go in peace, and do your part to make America beautiful. Amen.
Would you join us in singing God Bless America?